me to be with you and to share God's word. Whenever I think about St. Paul's, it always brings a lot of wonderful memory of mine being in UBS in the year 1988. That was the year I joined. In the first week, I was asked to visit St. Paul's because we wanted to be exposed to different church traditions. And that was the time Pastor M.M. Ross was ministering. And then I was visiting many of the churches. And often I used to come because of the pipe organ, which I liked so much in our church. And thankful to God, in 2019, in the beginning of December, I think it was on 1st of December, I was able to be with you and share God's word. That was my last visit to Pune. Thank you, dear Pastor Surya, for extending this invitation and also giving wonderful introduction about me and my background. I'm very much grateful to the St. Paul for your partnership for the sake of the gospel through Indian Evangelical Mission. And it is our prayer that during these days, we will continue to understand God's purposes. And as we look into the various passages of the scripture, it will become so real and meaning to us. We are in the season of lockdown, where we hear a lot about the death and so many other things. Things are coming standstill. Everything is uncertain. But this may be the time, once again, we may be able to reflect back the reign of God, what God wanted us to do, even in this time, because we have a God who speaks so louder in silence. And even in this situation, he is very active in the lives of the people. So it is my desire and prayer that the Lord will make our time together a great blessing. And as Pastor shared, I'll be sharing from the word. And this time, I'll be focusing much on three important areas. One is about God. Second is about God's people. And also about God's land. So this is a kind of a integration that we like to have. Since I come from the missions background, I'll be also linking those aspects on missions in various dimensions. And the reason why I picked up the mission, it is not because I'm a missionary, it's because these are the seasons. We are talking so much about the crucifixion of Jesus, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Few weeks back, we talked about the Pentecost. Then we talked about the Trinity last week. And Jesus gave us the commission to make the disciples. So everything is very much integrated. And the risen Christ given the commission to the church, that is the called out community, God's people, to make the disciples. Then he said, I'll be with you to the ends of the age. So making us to take this message of the kingdom of God. So that is our higher responsibility as the stewards of the gospel of Jesus Christ with the power of the Holy Spirit. So that's why I picked up the theme, God's mission through God's people in God's land. That is the theme I have taken up. And I'll go into the PowerPoint presentation. And as I'll be sharing, I'm sure that you will follow it up. I'll go a bit slow. Then we may be able to have some kind of questions or any doubts to be cleared that we can do. I hope you are able to see the screen. Is it?
Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah. If there is something, just give me the feedback. That will be a great help. Okay. So this is a theme that I have taken for this 2 months study. I thought of having it only for a week, month. And then there are a few more informations I wanted to share with all of us to make our theology, how to be a doing theology or doing mission. So I have integrated some more elements into my Bible study. So we will be doing a series of studies. So I request you to take part regularly and motivate other friends also to join with us. Today, we are going to see the profile for missions. It's a basic outline where we may be able to see God's mission, God's people, and God's land, how we want to move forward. And Lord willing, next week, we'll be seeing what are the programs involved in the mission of God. So this will be the next week study. And then we are going to see the power for missions. Hopefully, we'll be studying about the ministry of the Holy Spirit in God's mission. Then we will be seeing what we prayed for missions. When we have the power, we have to intercede, because it is not on our own experience or smartness. It is always a battlefield through prayer, how we can penetrate to different borders, transcending ourselves to make the message of the gospel. Then we are going to see the partners in missions. Hopefully next month, we'll be studying whole month from the aspect of the partners in missions. And there, after doing this study, we'll be taking the three dimensions. The partnership in workplace, see, to understand our calling as the disciples of Jesus Christ, how to consider our workplace as God's mission, where we are the ambassadors of God's word, and to integrate our work and God's mission together. Then the partnership through our family life, how the mission is becoming integral part of our family life, the center of our family life, because the family is created by God for that very purpose. And then we will see the partnership in the unpleasant circumstances. There are areas when things are normal, we do, but there are experiences we may go through, very unpleasant, but still the Lord is calling us to take the mission of God forward when things are very uncertain. So this is going to be the 8 outline for our Bible study for this month and next month. And today we are going to see the profile of the mission. So we are picked up from the book of from Luke chapter 24, and we'll be doing our studies. And before that, we will look to the Lord in prayer. Gracious God, we thank you once again for the joy of coming into your presence this evening time. Lord, we thank you for the St. Paul Church, who are able to bring people together regularly for the systematic word of studying the word of God, as we'll be meditating today from the major theme, the mission of God through God's people in God's land. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pray that you make your word so precious to us, so that we may be able to understand the message and what you wanted us to go. We may be able to understand the holistic perspective of mission, where we are not compartmentalizing, but every way we are integrated together. We pray for the ministry of the Holy Spirit to coordinate, though we are all placed in different places, though we do this through the technology, but Sovereign God, we pray that you be with us, help us to feel your presence afresh in the midst of all these things. In Jesus' mighty name we do pray. Amen. See, when you talk about the missions, people have different school of thoughts. Some people, they think that the mission starts after the resurrection of Jesus Christ, and when he has given the commission to the disciples after his resurrection, before his ascension, he said, go into the world. So people take from that perspective that there the mission starts. There is another school of thought. It says that, okay, after the fall of people, Genesis chapter 3, because of the fall of people, God has to work towards the mission. So these are the areas where people talk about different aspects. The passage which we have taken for our meditation is the last chapter of Luke chapter 24. And we are doing our study, especially from verse 44 till the end. And here we are able to see now Jesus was giving his mission. The mission, what Jesus was talking, is not all of a sudden emerged, but it was continuous, where Jesus came and made God's mission more clear to the people of God. And we see it here in chapter 24, verse 44. This is what Jesus said. This is what I told you while I was still with you. Everything fulfilled that is written about me in the law of Moses, the prophet, and the Psalms. Here, Jesus was bringing the Old Testament. When he was talking about thinking about the fulfillment, what was written, the mission is not starting from the New Testament or from the life of Jesus. It starts from Genesis 1:1. Here, Jesus brings out the beautiful three different important portions or the division of the Old Testament: the law of Moses, the Pentateuch, the Torah, the prophets, later part we see, the Psalms, the literature. So he talks about these are the three areas. I'm not going to give much explanation about that in order to make us to understand the mission. The Bible talks about the mission of God right from the beginning till the end. So Jesus came, and through Jesus, it was manifested. So when you're talking about the mission of God right now, we talk about God who revealed in Jesus Christ. So when you're talking about the mission, we are talking about the mission where God was revealed in Jesus Christ. That's very important as we are in the ecumenical world where we try to generalize everything. We are now in a place to keep Christ as the center of our lives. And when you're talking about the mission of God, it is talking about kingdom of God. It is not some activity that we are engaged in the relief of during this pandemic season or supporting our mission. And when you're talking about the mission of God, you are talking about the kingdom of God. You are talking about the reign of the kingdom of God in our lives, the rule and the reign of God. So God's mission is about the kingdom of God, and the kingdom of God is about the rule and the reign of God. And when you're talking about this, in one occasion, Jesus said, "For indeed the kingdom of God is with you." He talks about him, and we are able to see when we commit our lives into the Lordship of Jesus Christ, when he is in control of our lives, there we could see the kingdom of God. So when we surrender ourselves to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and when he takes control of our lives, where we become the disciples of Jesus Christ, and wherever we are, we become the ambassador for the mission of God. So friends, that's very important as we talk about the mission. It is not reaching some people in the jungle or in the place where people are marginalized or neglected. It is, of course, we proclaim the message of God. We proclaim the kingdom of God. We talk about the Lordship of Jesus Christ, where we commit ourselves. And the beautiful summary we could see about the kingdom of God is given in Romans chapter 14:17. It says that, "For the kingdom of God is not a matter of eating and drinking, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit." Beautiful verses. So when you talk about God's mission, it is talking about the kingdom of God. It is talking about the rules and the reign of God, and where we may be able to see the righteousness, peace, justice, joy with the power of the Holy Spirit. So this is what the mission of God is all about. And here, when we look into Luke chapter 24, and it is a beautiful passage which is giving the holistic understanding. And here we are able to see how the triune God is able to engage in God's mission. Last week we all observed as a Trinity Sunday, and we are able to see the triune God involved in the creation, the redemption, and also in the mission. So the Trinity is very much engaged in the mission of God. So the mission is from God, and he himself does the missionary work. And we are just the people who are journeying along with God. That is the beauty, because we have a God who made the covenant in our lives, and we are together in this journey. And Bishop Leslie Newbegin, this is what he said: "The mission is God's and not ours, but God chooses men and women for the services of his mission." See, friends, we are talking about God's mission, God's people, God's land. So the mission belongs to the Lord, and we are called to engage in God's mission where? On this earth, God's creation. So beautifully, we are able to see how the triune God is engaged. In the Old Testament, if you see,
We see the missionary concern of God the Father is seen in his promises and purposes. Wherever we see in the Old Testament, the concern of God the Father is seen in the promises. And then we see that is manifested through his Son, that his Son declares the missionary purpose in the ministry and the message. That's what we are going to see in a short while time. Then we see it is continued by the Holy Spirit, the activity of God's missionary purposes. So we could see how the concern of God was given to us through his promises and manifested through the Son. And then we see it is continued by the activity of the Holy Spirit. So when you talk about God's mission, it is talking about the kingdom of God, the rule and the reign of God, where we will be able to see the control, the sovereignty and the lordship of Lord Jesus Christ, because we are talking about God who is revealed in Jesus Christ, where the righteousness, peace, justice, joy, everything is in operation. And we see that triune God is engaged in God's mission. So that's why Jesus, when he was talking about, he was talking about how it has to be fulfilled, right from the law of Moses, then prophets, and then we see the Psalms. And then we see how Jesus, here in this particular passage, was giving us the outline or the profile for the missions. That's what we are going to see. Here we see in chapter 24, verse 45, it is saying that, chapter 24, verse 45, and it says that when you open the scripture, verse 46, it is written, it was necessary for Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead on the third day, and the repentance and the remission of sin should be preached in the name of Christ to all nations. So here we see the four important elements: repentance, forgiveness, suffering, resurrection, all these things based on the scripture. Verse 46, it says, when you're talking about what is the message or the mission, it is talking about the repentance, forgiveness, how it is coming through the suffering and the resurrection of Christ based on the scripture. So our reference is God's word. The mission emerges from the scripture, where we are able to see the repentance and the forgiveness. It came through the suffering and the resurrection of Lord Jesus Christ. And this is another very important message that we wanted to understand. When you talk about the repentance and forgiveness, I'd like to take you to another passage. Then we'll come back again here. It is like an expository study only we are doing from Luke chapter 24. But at the same time, when you are talking about the message, because Paul, when he was talking about the message of the cross, beautifully he was portraying here in Ephesians chapter 2, and we see it in verse, the entire chapter, we can say, it talks about how the coming of Jesus Christ, his suffering, his death on the cross, brought the message so relevant to different groups of people. So I'd like to concentrate a little bit about the message of Christ. Friends, as we listen to the word of God, it is my prayer. We cannot do God's mission without able to understand the message, not only understanding, making part and parcel of our lives. Always I tell our people, the messenger is very much important than the message. Though we can pass on the information to the people, we can engage. The conviction, it matters a lot. Sometimes we may not have the language to articulate what you wanted to communicate. But there are people who are very poor in the language, but the passion, the conviction, which communicates more powerfully to the people. So when you're talking about the message, Paul was able to bring this wonderful concept in Ephesians chapter 2. So here I'd like to share some of the areas. And it was talking about very beautifully what we were earlier, and then what happened because of the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ, what Jesus did. So who are we now? It is a beautifully, Paul talks about it in chapter 2. there are a few verses that I can pick it up and we can read it here. Verse 12, and let me read verse 12 and 12, it says that, at the time you are without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. See, it talks about at the time. Who are we? We are aliens and we are strangers. We are without hope, without God. It talks about our past life. The message of the gospel brings the newness. One of the songs which we often sing is the "Oh, what a wonderful, wonderful day. Day I will never forget." Why? Because this was my life. But now, because Jesus did something. So here, Paul brings five different beautiful pictures. Friends, as you are talking about the missions, and if the Spirit of God is speaking to us, some of the areas where we need to align with the understanding. See, we have two understandings all the time. One is the worldview, what people think about in this world. Another is the biblical world, what the Bible is talking about. We live in a world of deception where we are not able to understand what the Bible talks about and also what the world is talking about. We have come to a point that almost everything is the same. But as we listen to the word of God, even today, if the Lord is speaking to us, let us yield to the Lord. Five important messages, when you talk about the repentance and the forgiveness through the suffering and resurrection of Jesus Christ, according to the scripture, Paul beautifully, he brings out this picture. Five elements I'll just talk. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 1 to 4, it says that at the time, it says that who are dead in trespasses and sins, in which once you walked according to the course of the world, according to the prince of the powers of the air, and the spirit who now works in the sons of disobedience, among whom also we once conduct ourselves in the lust of flesh, fulfilling the desire of the flesh and of the mind, but by nature children of wrath, just as others. Verse 2 and 3, it talks about when we are dead in trespasses and sin, what are the things happen in our lives? It talks about we have become the past of the year, disobedient people, are the children of disobedience, and we fulfill the desire of the lust of the world. All those things are talking about. Why? Because we are totally dead to the sin. And we are not able to see these are the things which is not pleasing God because our conscience was dead. And Paul says that. But verse 5, it says that now, even when we are dead in trespasses, God made us alive together with Christ. And that is a beautiful message. It is the grace of God. So by the grace of God, we are made alive. So Paul brings the beautiful picture. At that time, you are dead in trespasses and sin. Now, because the grace of God, you are made alive. So now I am raised. Verse 5, it says that I am and raised up together. Verse 6, it says, I am raised up together. So because Jesus suffered and resurrected from the dead through the message of the repentance and the forgiveness, once I was dead in trespasses and sin, now made alive because of the grace of God, so bold enough to say that I am raised. Now I have the new life, new chapter. And then Paul talks about the second verse 13, the beautiful picture. It says that, but now in Christ, once you are far, have been brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. It says that once you are far, because of sin, I was not able to come near to God. But now I was brought near. That is the miracle. Who are far from God, now brought near by the blood of Jesus Christ. So what happened? Who are brought near to Christ, and because of that, I am redeemed. That's a wonderful message. The redemption is nothing but the separated person, now free from all sorts of the guiltiness. Now I can come and near to the righteous God, because I have surrendered myself to the control of the sovereign God. Friends, this is what, now you know, you may be sitting here, how your heart is. whether it is very near to God or you are far away from God. The third aspect, when you're talking about the message, verse 14 says that, "For he himself is our peace, who made both one and broken down the middle wall of separation." And then it says that, "Having abolished in his flesh the enmity, that is the law of commandment." Okay. At the time, there was a wall of separation, and that brought the enmity. And because of Jesus Christ, and it says that now we become peace. God made both one because of the peace of God. So there was a wall of separation, enmity. You are not able to see each other, but because Jesus broke down the wall of separation. Friends, it may be our perspective, our backgrounds, even our languages, whatever may be, which may bring a wall of separation. See, the separation comes because of our worldview. In some of the churches, we have people are divided on the name of the languages, region, and so many other ways. But in Jesus Christ, all separations were broken down. There was no enmity. We become peace because we are made one. So we can bold enough say that we are reconciled. See, that's the message of the gospel. And third, what happened? We see it in verse 15, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 15. It says that now, it says that, "So as to create in himself one new man from the two." It talks about that my old nature has gone, now the new nature has come. How? Because of the cross of Jesus Christ, I crucified everything on the cross. It is no longer I, because Jesus became the center of my life. I have given my life to the sovereign control of Jesus Christ. I have yielded myself to him, where I said, "Lord, you take control. Let the visitation of the Holy Spirit transform me." Spirit of the living God, we sing that song. Allowing the Spirit of God to transform our nature. And because of that, we are renewed. That is what the miracle. Then finally, we see, it says in chapter 2, verse 19, "Therefore, you were no longer strangers and foreigners, but fellow citizens with saints and the members of the household of God." It says that at the time you are foreigners and strangers, but now you become the fellow citizens and saints. Hallelujah. This is the wonderful message of the mission of God. Jesus came into this world because of that. He's coming through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. And we are able to see that now I am recognized. So for a child of God, we no need to live with an identity crisis. That is the good news. Now we are all looking for the other card or some kind of identity card. Yes, of course, that is needed as per the law of the land. But for a child of God, we no need to live with a ill feeling that I am nobody, because we are wonderfully and created by God. The Lord affirms that we are fellow citizens and saints. Friends, this is what the message. It is not just the activity that we are engaged. See, these are the days when you are talking about the mission, we think that it is doing something for the neglected and marginalized. Yes, that is part of that. That is a manifestation of this message. Sometimes we are missing this particular element, even from the theological perspective. The mission of God, this is what is. The message is very much important. Friends, we are called this message, the message of the mission of God. I said, through God's people, we are the carriers of this mission. Friends, this evening as we are listening to the word of God, the Lord is speaking to us. Do we know Jesus Christ in our lives? Are we still live with some hidden sins of our life? Do we still have a barrier away from God? Do we have consistent walk with Jesus Christ, regularly reading God's word, allowing the Spirit of God to minister to us, or are we busy with our own schedule? What about our relationship in our family, in our church, with our colleagues, even in the office? Do we live with the separation, the wall of separation? What is our motives? This is what the message is all about. Is there anyone living with a feeling that I'm very new to the city? Nobody's here to take care. Friends, if that is thing, the good news this evening is, no, your fellow citizens and saints, you are part and parcel in the kingdom of God. You are recognized by God. That's a good news. Okay. First we saw, I took some time more for this, because when you talk about the missions, it is talking about so many things. Even in the theological circle, we are talking about the globalization, environment, we are talking about the gender justice. We are talking, these are the manifestation of all these things. Because of all those things, we are able to bring those things, that although the outcome of all these messages, unless we deal all these things, we cannot see the permanency or the mission of God. First, the message, the repentance and the forgiveness through the suffering and the resurrection of Christ based on the scripture. So that's why I took little time to explain all those things. So when you're talking about God's mission, let us keep all those things. And secondly, okay, first the message we saw. And secondly, we see what is the mandate. We'll go back to Luke chapter 24. What is the mandate the Lord has given? Verse 47, it says that the mandate is, it should be preached in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. Sharing the message to all the nations, beginning at Jerusalem. Okay, so we are talking about God's land. So the message is given to us. Jesus died on the cross, and it should be proclaimed to the nations across the borders. Taking this, so we are called to begin from the place where we are, and we are to take from one level to other level. That's why we see it in Acts chapter 1:8. Few days back, we celebrate the day of Pentecost, where the message is, when you receive the Holy Spirit, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. And this is where the mission is coming out. The land should be filled with the glory of God. How the glory of God will come? Because the righteousness, because the peace, because the right, because the joy, the justice, the equality, all that is manifested because of Lord Jesus Christ. So the message should be able to go to the ends of the earth. And that is the responsibility of the church. See, God's mission is done through God's people. God's people are the church, the body of Christ. So the highest responsibility of the body of Christ, the church, is to engage in God's mission. That's why the church becomes an agent of God's mission. So the higher responsibility of the church, see, sometimes we have a very wrong understanding when you think about the church is the top and where the other groups are coming, like the missions. See, the ultimate is God's mission. And God uses the church, the called out community, to fulfill God's purposes. And what we are talking, the church, what we are having, the mission movements like IEM, FMBB, that is another structure. And there are other institutions like the schools, hospitals, theological institution. These are the normal three structures that we are having: church, mission movements, and the institution. All the structures are then linked with the mission of God, Missio Dei, God's mission. where we are interrelated to each other. It is our responsibility to take the gospel of Christ to the ends of the earth. And thirdly, what is the method? Verse 48, we see here in verse 48, it says that you are the witness of these things, who through the human witnesses, men and women, people who enjoyed or enjoying, because we experience the repentance and forgiveness. We talked about the exposition of this message from Ephesians chapter 2, five different ways. Because we are raised from dead and we are renewed, recognized, we are reconciled, and we are redeemed. All those things we saw about it. And when we enjoy all those things, we become the partakers. See, sometimes people say that I need a calling to serve God. Friends, it is something like automatically activated. When you surrender your life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, when you become the disciple of Jesus Christ, without saying anything, automatically it is activated, where you are becoming the responsible person to carry the message of the gospel to the ends of the earth, for which we no need to have any calling. Someone said, to keep silent only you need calling. So we cannot escape by saying that. It beautifully say that. And we are the witnesses. The gospel can be, the mission can be promoted through the witness of the people who experience. Fourthly, what is the means? Chapter 24, verse 49, it says that, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with the power from on high. The Holy Spirit. When you receive the Holy Spirit, you become the visible witness of Jesus Christ, because we cannot do the mission of God on our own. We can do God's mission only with the help of the Holy Spirit. Friends, sometimes mission is not just engaging in something through our personal life or through our church life or through our family life. Mission begins with our life. Mission starts with our lifestyle, our transformation, renewal of our mind, setting the right priorities, having the right values of our lives. It is where the mission is coming very alive. Unless we experience or touch by the risen Christ, without the transformation, we cannot bring the transformation in the lives of individuals, families, and the communities. Our transformed life, that can make a great impact in the lives of the people. Friends, as our pastor was sharing about me, my parents are missionaries for almost 57 years. On 6th of May, my father went to be with the Lord after serving among the different tribes in Tamil Nadu. When he left Kanyakumari, that's our native place, where he was pastoring, and started the mission wing of the diocese called Diocesan Missionary Prayer Band. As he was pastoring the church, the Lord called him to be a missionary to work through NMS in Javadi Hills. And after coming there, I was born, and my younger sister, we are five in our family. And I was studying in the neighboring town called Tripathu, which is part of Vellore district. I was studying and staying in a hostel called YMCA. I was very active in my local hostel and also in the church, playing various instruments, playing those days harmonium, then the organ, keyboard, guitar, all I learned when I was small. My favorite is accordion. I was very active. Sometimes wearing my half trouser, I used to stand on the pulpit, raise my voice and preach. So there are occasions when my friends went for movies, I was all alone sitting in the hostile because I'm a child of God and also I'm a pastor's or a missionary's son. It was in the year 11, it was in my 11th standard. I was put in a Catholic institution, Don Bosco, near Tuvalu. And a particular moment, I was very much disturbed. There was no other church. I grumbled myself and told my father I am in a wrong place. Then I could see in the mass, I was able to go only to the Catholic worship service. The father used to play the organ discord. My blood used to boil. Again, I wrote to one of my friends saying that I am in the wrong place. My skills are not used. See, sometimes the talented people run from one church to another. It is not because of the love of God, because of something. I'm talking out of my experience. Though I was 16 years old, but I was totally gripped with the self. And my friend wrote to me saying that there are four gospels in the Bible, but the fifth gospel is your life. When I was with bitterness, I sent a letter saying that I'm in the wrong place because I'm not able to use my skills. He sent a message saying that there are four gospels in the Bible, but the fifth gospel is your life. There's a five-piece postcard. As I was going through, the Spirit of God spoke to me in the study hall as I was holding this particular postcard. The Lord asked me, are you eligible to be the fifth gospel? Because I thought in my understanding, because of my engagement in playing the instrument, singing the song, leading the choir, and a son of a missionary. So sometimes we talk about our backgrounds. I thought that is what my relationship with Christ. But I was fully under the control of my self, ego. And that was the time the Lord dealt that area. Raja, because of you, all those things, what you say, are you able to glorify me or you? I said, Lord, by using all these things, I always love to glorify me. That was the time I said, Lord, if I glorify me, I cannot be the fifth gospel. I cannot glorify you, a name. I cannot be the ambassador of your mission. That was the time with my innocency. I just prayed to the Lord, Lord, you should increase. I should decrease. I commit my life into your mighty hand. I tell you, when I made that, there was a new beginning in my life. There was a new perspective. I was able to change my mind. I was able to see the things in a different manner. My value system changed. My thought process changed, where I was able to see the control of the Holy Spirit and under the control of the sovereign God, the new mission emerged in my life. That's what we said. Paul beautifully said, I was like that now because of him. Four aspects we saw. I am raised. I am redeemed. I am renewed. I am reconciled. And I am recognized or rewarded by God. That's what the mission is all about. It is not some activity, but bringing a radical change in my aspiration, in my attitude, because Jesus came in my life. Because of my love for Jesus, the mission begins. It is not because of the need somewhere, because of my love for Jesus, where the mission begins and march forward. Whether we go through ups and downs, because of the love of God, Paul says, it compels me to engage in God's mission. It is my prayer that we'll have such a wonderful time as we join the mission of God, as we are studying God's mission through God's people in God's land. May God bless you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Doctor, for your wonderful talk. Friends, now if you have any doubts or if you need more clarification, now is the time to ask Dr. Raja Singh. Please unmute your mic and you can speak. No questions? That's good. All of you got it fully, I think.
Yeah, if you have any questions, you can pass it on to your pastor. Then you can ask me later also.
Pastor, this is Rebecca.
Yes, Sister Rebecca. Yes, Rebecca.
Yeah, I liked what you said about, you know, when we think about missions, it has to begin with us first. When you were dealing with verse 49, I think, and you said when you talk about missions, that it has to begin with us, with our lives. It's so true. It's so true. We can't go about or wanting to do God's work without changing our lives and seeing whether we have changed and whether we, our lives are in accordance to what God wants us to be.
Thank you.
Any questions from the passages which we discussed? Oh, good. Everybody understood fully, I hope. Okay, if there is no question, then we can wind up with prayer. Shall I pray then? One more minute I give. Okay, good. No questions, I hope. Let us pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you for this wonderful opportunity which you have given to us. Lord, we thank you for sharing with us about your mission. Many times we don't understand that it should come out from our heart because of the love which we have for you. Many times we consider that as our responsibilities and duties, and we do it in that way only. Lord, we thank you for speaking to us. Help us to love you more so that we can continue to do your ministry in a better way. Lord, we commit all the participants unto your keeping. We thank you for speaking to each and every one of them. May your blessing be upon each and every one of us continuously. Lord, as you are going through a very difficult situation, we ask you to keep all of us under your wings. Keep us safe and sound so that, Lord, even in this lockdown time, we can continue to share your gospel in the way you want us to share, and your name will be glorified. Lord, we ask you to bless this evening in a very special way. Grant us good rest so that in the morning we can get up with new strength and we can continue to serve you in a better way. Lord, till we meet again in your presence, may your blessing, protection, and good health be upon each and every one of us. Once again, we commit the resource person, Dr. Raja Singh, unto your keeping. We ask you to bless his ministry, bless his family life, help him to glorify your good name through his life and also through his ministry. Lord, as you are getting ready to leave this virtual connection, we let your blessing be upon us continuously. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Shall we all join together in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you all. Good night. Thank you, Reverend, for the wonderful sharing. I think it is very much from the Bible directly, so there was no doubt or question from our members, I hope. Next week, we'll meet the same time. Thank you. God bless you. Good night.
Pastor, if you don't mind, just one alert to everyone on the panel today who are attending. Tomorrow, St. Paul's Church prayer fellowship time at 7 p.m. in the evening. Tomorrow at 7 p.m.
Thank you. So we request all of you to attend that.
Thank you. Next week we'll meet in the same time.
Good night.
Thank you, Dr. Brother.
Thank you. Nice to see all of you.
Thank you, Dr.
Good beginning.
George, I finally could manage.
I know. I saw you on. I said, oh, finally did it. What had happened? Your net was not connected.
No, Sandeep sent another link, or I don't know what he said.